Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The only item on our public agenda today is an evidence session with Scottish Government officials to discuss the Scottish Government's response to the Committee's report on the original financial memorandum for the National Care Service Scotland Bill, as well as the information presented in the updated financial memorandum, which was provided to Committee on 11th of December last year. We are joined today by Donna Bell, Director of Social Care and National Care Service Development, Lee Flanagan, National Care Service Senior Finance Manager, and Richard McCallum, Director of Health and Social Care, Finance, Digital and Governance. And I understand that Ms Bell is going to make a brief opening statement. So I welcome you to the committee. And I should also mention that Ross Greer, one of our committee members, is struggling to get here in time due to transport difficulties, but he hopes to be here before too long. So Donna, over to you.
Great. Thank you, Convener, and thanks for inviting us today to talk about the financial information for the NCS Bill. As you say, we provided a response to the committee on the 11th of December, and that was, I think, fairly fulsome. The National Care Service is a central component of our investment strategy towards sustainable public services, and we remain committed to taking this programme forward. The response to the Finance Committee Stage 1 report set out an update to the costs in the bill as introduced as an updated financial memorandum and an explanatory document of that financial memorandum, and also the Scottish Government's proposed changes to the bill for Stage 2 as a financial implications document, following the shared accountability discussions with COSLA and the NHS. The response also included a programme business case outlining the background to the finances and the basis behind our proposed reforms. We believe that this does provide a substantial and robust package to explain what would happen if the bill continued as it is, or if it was amended in the way that the Scottish Government would wish. Subject to the will of the Parliament, the Scottish Government proposed to make amendments to the bill at Stage 2, as we've described. And that's in response to evidence taken at Stage 1, the ongoing feedback from stakeholders and evidence as part of the Scottish Government's co-design programme. So what has changed in the updated financial memorandum, which relates to the bill as introduced? The update gives a revised costing associated with the bill as introduced, while also providing greater detail behind underlying assumptions and calculations to aid with the committee's scrutiny of the costs. In consideration of the current financial position nationally and within the Scottish Government, we've reviewed what is achievable. It's expected that the national level part of the NCS, as part of the core Scottish Government, will be established during 25-26. And in the bill as introduced, NCS local care boards were assumed to go live in 2029. The costs outlined in the updated FM have been rephased across a 10-year period from 22-23 to 2031-32 to account for this. So there are some significant financial moves between this update and the original financial memorandum. So what would change in the Scottish Government's proposed amendments to the bill at Stage 2? The main change is primarily the delivery mechanism and accountability. The three main changes from the shared accountability discussions are that local authorities will retain responsibility for all current functions and the delivery of social work and social care services, and there will be no transfer of staff or assets on that basis. Reforming integration authorities rather than creating new care boards, and the establishment of a National Care Service Board, which we expect will be responsible for a range of duties, including setting national strategic direction, developing standards, guidance and operating frameworks, overseeing and seeking delivery assurance on local strategic plans, etc., etc. The Minister's powers to intervene outlined in the bill as introduced will likely become part of the role of the National Board proposed. So the financial implications of the proposed changes, as I've said, are significant. We've taken account of the very challenging fiscal environment and reassessed the original proposals with relevant stakeholders. We're proposing to take a phased approach to implementation as outlined in the 11th December correspondence to the committee. And we believe that this is the most responsible and feasible approach that we can now take in a very different economic climate. Under the shared accountability approach, the costs drop substantially. So excluding the carer's break cost, the NCS-specific costs over the 10-year timeframe drop from an estimated £487 million, the range is £487 million to £1.6 million to 238 to 345 million, which is a saving of 249 million to 1.2676 billion. If the Parliament agrees to our proposed changes at stage two, the cost of this bill will decrease substantially. The costs of the bill reduce by removing the need to set up care boards and to transfer staff and assets, and there will be some new costs associated with reforming integration authorities and establishing a national board, but overall costs are significantly reduced. Costs are also reduced by the new proposal because it phases reforms over a much longer time frame than originally intended. I think it's important to note what has not changed as much as what has. The vision for the NCS remains unchanged. While the delivery mechanisms for the NCS might now be different, the vision as set out in the policy memorandum at the time of introduction remains the same. Scottish Government remains committed to respond to the need for reform, with significant changes needed at local level to realise the intended quality and consistency required. By providing timely support when it is needed, we can reduce overall service costs in the long term and empower people to maintain their physical and mental health, which in turn creates a healthier overall economy.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that opening statement. I mean, over the 10-year period, total costs under revised proposals will now amount to between £631 million and £916 million, and that's a variance of around 45%, and that compares with the estimated costs over the equivalent 10-year period of between £880 and £2192 million, which is a variance of around 150%. So there's been a huge improvement in terms of the variance and how the costs have been assessed. So, as you've said in your opening statement, that means the revised proposals represent substantially lower overall costs, estimated to between £249 and £1,276 million. And I think, you know, if this committee had accepted the previous financial memorandum, then the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament over 10 years, it seems to me, would be between £249 and £1,276 million worse off, and we'd have all the issues of transfer of staff, etc., which is now not going to be included in the bill. But I think the central issue that we're actually dealing with is, given the changes that have been made, these dramatic changes to costings and reassessment by the Scottish Government over the last year or so, how can we have faith in the figures that are being presented over a 10-year period?
Thank you, Convener. So, as you say, we've been able to really pin down the costs and reduce the range, as you've described. So we're now in a much more certain position about the way forward. Certainly the range of variables that the previous approach presented were much more significant and, frankly, much more variable. So we've worked hard with colleagues to present what we believe is a much more certain approach. While there is still a range, and you would expect us to build in a range of costs because of, obviously, future potential uncertainty, we're confident that we have the best possible estimates here in the financial memorandum and in the shared accountability paper for you to scrutinise.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, if one looks at the financial memorandum and in every area of cost, I note that from financial year 2023-24, the current year up to 2031-32, which is an 8-year period, it looks to me like in every one of these categories there's a 41.5% estimated increase in costs. Now, how that appears to be assessed is assuming a 2% inflation rate plus 3% increase in real terms. So we're talking about a 25% increase in real terms, which, you know, given the fact that the Scottish budget is not growing in real terms at 3% a year and is unlikely to, it seems to me, how can you be confident that these figures are actually sustainable and deliverable?
Thank you, Convener. So we've used the standard inflators, and I know that we've had conversations before about CPI and GDP. So we have used essentially standard approaches to increasing costs. So we know that those are also changeable. The GDP information is currently significantly lower than CPI. So I think it's important that we have noted the possibilities of future increased costs and ensured that we've taken the worst case scenario to build in the most, if you like, pessimistic approach. So I think while we can do that, we don't have full certainty there. I think the, and Richard, you might want to come in here on the future budget position, but certainly the budget choices of the future are made on an annual basis, and we would expect that choices will be made at the time on where to invest.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's right. I mean, it will be obviously subject to the annual the annual budget process, and we will go through that. Obviously, we understand what's in the financial memorandum as set out, and that will be factored into to the budget process. I suppose the other point I would make is that, yes, whilst there is the constraints on the overall Scottish Government budget, there has been that increase in both health and social care investment that has run ahead of the overall uplift or the growth that we've seen in the Scottish Government budget more widely. So even if we take something like social care pay, which is the real living wage moving from £10.90 to £12 an hour in 24-25, that alone is obviously greater than the uplift that we've seen in other parts of the budget. So I think it's reflecting that trying to take that prudent approach that CPI gives as we build this in and as we plan moving forward.
Yeah, and I just don't know how it's going to actually be sustainable, you know, given the current projections by the Scottish Fiscal Commission. But I mean, you talk about CPI, and I think, you know, in this committee we've discussed types of inflation, you know, whether we like it or not, and I'm not one who does really like it. I mean, I think using the GDP deflator is unrealistic when we think of salary increases, for example, over the last year or whatever, or the expenditure on capital. But the reality is that is what the Scottish Government has used, the Treasury GDP deflator across its current budget, and it just seems a wee bit out of kilter to use a measure that other areas of the Scottish Government don't seem to use. So why was it decided that, you know, whereas we're not using it, you know, elsewhere in the Scottish budget, why is the CPI being used? And the issue you talk about in terms of, you know, salaries, etc. Yeah, understandable, but that's the case with other areas of the Scottish budget. We still have to use a GDP deflator.
I'll hand over to Lee on this.
Camilla, that was when we were looking through factoring some of the costs, we'd compared the excuse me, the GDP deflator against CPI. I had a couple of discussions with some of our analytical colleagues, and because the GDP deflator doesn't include the import costs, and because of the issue with imported gas, it just looked artificially low. And because of what we're trying to establish here was...
Sorry, it is artificially low, but it's artificially low across the entire Scottish budget.
It could
be,
yeah,
the point I'm making, you know.
Yeah, no, I was going to say, but for the costing perspective, and we're looking to try and be as prudent as possible and not undersell what the potential cost could be, it was just felt that was potentially a more prudent estimate to not understate the cost. Now, we could have referred to the GDP deflator, but in that situation, because of the significant impact that not factoring in import cost of natural gas has on it, it just felt too low. And because of what we're trying to do and set out a realistic cost base, we figured it was better to edge being potentially slightly higher than potentially slightly under. And we ran through it with some of the analytical colleagues before we decided on it, and they were comfortable as well with the use of CPI as a measure.
Convener, I mean, if it would be helpful to the committee, we would be happy to run the figures again based on the GDP deflator rather than the CPI.
It's just that we're comparing apples with oranges with regards to the rest of the Scottish budget. Otherwise, it just seems really odd that one particular aspect of the Scottish budget should be different from the rest in terms of it. I mean, I think we all agree that the GDP deflator is not necessarily a realistic assessment, and hasn't been certainly in the last current years, although the SFC hope that in the next 2 or 3 years we might be more aligned with the GDP deflator. But the reality is it's just what we're using, you know.
Error on our part. It was across the whole piece when we'd be looking at costs, we'd always, in all areas of the various different costs, even though the costs are also significantly lower, we tried not to be too optimistic almost that the costs might be less, because there's always a worry that you put out a set of costs and the reality then doesn't match up with that and you've underestimated it. I always felt across piece what we've done, if we slightly overestimate it, it's a better position to be in than underestimating it, because it gives a better indicator of potential scale then.
Mm. Would it be helpful, convener, to see the costs rerun?
Yes, it would be, actually. That would be, certainly be helpful
for
us on that, you know. Moving on, the Fraser Valander Institute has noted particular uncertainties in relation to the costings provided for rights to breaks from caring due to a lack of data at local authority level and no specific allocation for care or respite in the local government settlement. Now, that's obviously an issue of concern, because proportionately in the new financial memorandum, annual costs are going to increase from between £155 and £225 million. So given that caveat made by Fraser Valander, I'm just wondering if you can explain how you came to these figures.
Yes, convener, happy to. So the updated data that we received just at the beginning of December certainly helped us to refine the costs. And there were a number of new pieces of information that helped us to do that. I'll maybe hand over to Lee to take you through the specifics there. But certainly we are obviously still operating within quite a large range there. And we'll continue to refine that as we go. But Lee, could you maybe talk through the
detail? Yeah, so it was one of our colleagues that had pulled together the rights to break calculation, and it's a very detailed calculation. There's a significant number of different variables built in within it. I think when chatting with Paul, who pulled it together, it was, in terms of the cost differential, there was kind of three main parts to it. The new Scottish Health Survey data that just released on the 5th of December showed a drop in the number of overall carers. Now, the basis behind that was the prior report that went out was done during COVID, and it was also done by a number of telephone consultations, which seemed to overestimate the number of carers that were sitting in that based on the historical data. So the number of carers came down. What also came out, though, was the intensity of the care has ramped up based on the new figures. The other factor, the main differential between the previous iteration and this one, was in the original financial memorandum, the costs were based on the 22-23 unit rates and they were continued all the way through, whereas in this instance we've got the new 23-24 unit rates, but they've also then built in on inflation based on the same inflationary assumptions that we have. So they've been the main drivers behind the cost. I don't know if it would be helpful to the committee, because we'd got a note of this before coming. It's a very detailed calculation in the background. If it would be helpful for the committee, we can obviously send that on to set out the detail behind the assumptions that were made. Because having had a run through it myself in conjunction with the person, it's a very detailed calculation with a significant number of obviously assumptions and variables that are built in within it.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, the Scottish Government and COSLA are operating a partnership approach to provide legal accountability, and accountability was one of the things you touched on in your opening statement, Donna. And this is to improve the experience of people accessing services by introducing a new structure of national oversight to drive consistency of outcomes while maximising the benefits of reformed local service delivery. And this will provide Scottish ministers, local authorities and NHS boards with overarching shared accountability for the care system. Now, is this not a bit of a recipe for confusion? So how will this partnership with local authorities, NHS boards, Scottish ministers relate to the new national board? The exact format of which is still to be decided.
Yes. So, as you say, convener, the exact format is yet to be fully agreed. We have obviously been able to agree the potential functions for the board, and we outlined them, the national board, and we outlined them in the letter to you in December. So the intention is that shared accountability will be discharged through the national board. So there will be membership from representatives of Scottish ministers, of local government and of the NHS, and it's likely that there will also be other members to make sure that people with lived and living experience are represented, and whether they be people who are using services or people who have caring responsibilities, and indeed staff side representatives too. But the exact combination of membership is not yet decided. So the intention is that that board will have oversight of the provision of community health and social care in Scotland. It will have the opportunity to engage with local areas and understand how their strategic planning is working, how their ethical commissioning strategies are working, and also overseeing and seeking delivery assurance on that local strategic planning. I think one important change is the monitoring of system performance to ensure consistent and fair social care support and community health services. And that is a significant change. We would propose to maintain a support and improvement framework which will aim to provide support to local areas when monitoring indicates that they are needing support and that standards are not being met. And that's also attached to powers of intervention when required as a last resort. So coupled with that, we will need to ensure visibility of data, information and analysis about community health and social care support, social work and other areas covered by integration authorities. So I think there is an opportunity there to, I suppose, drive up standards, ensure consistency, and the intention is that the people around that table will hold each other to account for their statutory responsibilities, and that it will be a transparent approach. One of the things that has come to us throughout the co-design, particularly with people and with staff who work in social care and community health, is the issues around transparency of how decisions are made, the transparency of data, the transparency on performance. So I think this board will really help with that.
Okay, I mean, thank you. It does sound, you know, from the length and detail of your answer, though, that we're in a situation whereby we still don't know really where we are with the National Care Board. And, you know, we're going to stage one in only a few weeks. And I would imagine that, well, I know for certain that parliamentarians will want much, will want answers at that, in that stage one debate, will demand them of the minister. So, when the hatch is going to be battened down on this, but will we have that information before the stage one debate?
So I think we've given a fair amount of information to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, which outlines the functions and responsibilities of the National Board. We've also provided information about the relationship with local integration authorities. The intention is that they will account to the National Board through the mechanisms that we will put in place. So we've given quite a detailed set of information on responsibilities and functions. I think the membership is something that is going to be really important, and we still have work to do on that, but we wouldn't be proposing to put that in primary legislation given the potential changeability of that. And there will be further detail in the secondary legislation that sets out the exact nature of the board. And there is also a read across to the Public Bodies Act 2014 for local partnerships, as I described, because we aren't planning to have care boards. The intention is to reform integration authorities.
I mean, do you see this as being a fairly, you know, small, perfectly formed board like, you know, Community Justice Scotland with maybe 45 staff members, or do you see this a much more encompassing organisation? Because I think we need more clarity in terms of the costs and staff numbers. If you get any kind of information you can share with us on that?
Yeah, so, I mean, Lee can talk through the detail of the assumptions for the National Board, but we are expecting that it will not be an expansive board. We're obviously conscious of good use of public funds. We've still got work to do to to finally define exactly the numbers. I think we also need to think about the interaction with what government does at the moment, what COSLA do at the moment, and what the NHS do at the moment. So the directorate that I run at Scottish Government obviously has a number of staff. We will need to think quite carefully about the distribution of duties, how functions are discharged, and it may be that there is some cross-referencing there and cross-substitution that we'll need to think about.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm struggling to have confidence in this process, given how far on we are. I mean, it's now 15 months since we last discussed and deliberated over the previous financial memorandum, and one would have thought some of this would have been pinned down a bit more by now. So, just moving on, because colleagues will now want to come in with further questions on that area. The issue, one of the issues that's concerned the committee from the start has been co-design. I mean, as a committee, we're much more in favour of having primary legislation because for scrutiny reasons and also because it helps pin down the costs. I mean, the problem with the framework and co-design approach is that there are increased uncertainties surrounding the cost estimates and the timing of these costs. So given the fact that it has been around 15 months since we last deliberated over financial memorandum, how have we moved forward in terms of co-design, and how much of that co-design will now be incorporated into the primary legislation, perhaps through amendments at stage two?
Thanks, Convener. And if it would be helpful, just referring to your previous question, we can give you the breakdown of the assumptions around staff for the National Board, unless, of course, it comes up in further conversation.
I'm quite happy if you tell us that, yeah?
Yeah, okay. So the co-design work has been very intensive over the past 9 months. We did a huge amount of work over the summer with people engaged with thousands of people who use services, who work in services, on five themes. So keeping care support local, information sharing, making sure my voice is heard, realising rights and responsibilities, and valuing the workforce. So we've taken all of that information, and that has helped us to refine the primary legislation. And one of the key things for us, obviously we've been engaging with colleagues from local government and colleagues from the NHS who have particular views about how they think things should move forward. We've balanced that with what we've heard from the co-design work, and this is an approach that we feel presents a good consensus based on the engagement with public sector partners, third sector partners, and with people and staff. So we have factored that in to the activity, and I think we said in the letter to you that the co-design for primary legislation is effectively concluded, and we will move on to the development of further work on areas like the charter, on complaints and advocacy, etc. So I think we've made significant progress, certainly since we last spoke.
And so much of that will come in at stage two?
So I think we have a good understanding of what is required for the secondary legislation already. I think we're expecting that, well, obviously there will be amendments presented, but we certainly have a good understanding of the amendments that the government will likely present, and they are outlined in the letter that we sent to you.
Now, obviously, you know, there are some costs associated with NHS board, but they are kind of quite varied, from £20 to £29 million. But the estimated costs have been rounded up to near a million, with the result that any cost below £500,000 have been rounded to zero. And this makes it difficult to understand the detail of the costings and whether the costs are indeed zero or just below the threshold. Why has there not been a bit more detail put into that? I mean, if something costs £421,000 and something else costs £385,000, why not just add them all up to try and narrow the kind of variances here? It just seems a wee bit, when you're just presented with these kind of bulk figures, you know, very rounded, it just doesn't look very, it's almost they've been plucked, you know, rather than actually assessed effectively?
I mean, I can assure you that they haven't been plucked.
I'm sure, but it's just how it looks.
For sure. And certainly that's, I mean, it's a presentational issue for us. I mean, we're very happy to give you the detailed figures. I mean, Lee, I know that you worked hard to make sure that we are absolutely clear about what's needed. So if there is a rounding, we're very happy to provide you with the exact figures. Or is there a specific area you want to...
It was, so just to quickly jump in, Donna says the totals were rounded just in keeping with the original financial memorandum to the millions, but the backing calculations, all three of them, are obviously down to essentially the pounds. The overall totals as well are not rounded, so it's not the rounded totals that then factor in the total total. The total is based off the actual specific numbers. It's literally just presentationally. We've just kept it to millions. We can give a more detailed breakdown. I've got it sitting, so we can show it. It was just to keep the consistency format was the reason behind it.
I've just one of these people who likes precise figures, and we've had plenty of financial memorandums over the years that have done exactly that. Okay, just one more question from me, because I know colleagues are keen to come in, and it's about additional Scottish Government staff costs. I mean, the final section of the new FM notes that the certain Scottish Government staff costs have already been incurred in the region of £10 million per annum and will continue to be incurred even if the proposals didn't go ahead. So, you know, I'm just wondering what these staff are currently engaged in, what the role will be if the NHS proposals don't go ahead. There doesn't seem to be any details on the number of staff involved, salaries, grades, etc. It's just a kind of, you know, region of £10 million. It's not very, you know, transparent, should we say.
Yeah, I mean, and again, we're very happy to provide a breakdown if that would be helpful. I mean, the £10 million that you refer to is associated with the development of the NCS, and we did talk about this a bit before. There's obviously the bill development activity, but there is, everything that you see outlined in the bill has a development need, which is being addressed by staff in the directorate at the moment. More broadly, the directorate also covers social care improvement. It covers policy development for a whole range of social care policy aspects like carers, self-directed support. There are multiple aspects of performance and delivery. And the reason that we have said that those costs would continue to be incurred is that we would need to continue to carry out that work regardless of whether the NCS was going to be in place or not.
Okay, I'll let others ask further questions on that. But just as at the table two of the new financial memorandum shows cost to the Scottish administration between 128 and 193 million, but it's unclear whether those are associated with the establishment of the board. I mean, this new financial memorandum is only 9 pages. The previous one was 28 pages, and it just feels as if there's a, you know, there could have been a wee bit more detail in some of it.
Yeah, I mean, we have all the underlying assumptions, and I think as we move forward, the shared accountability paper, which obviously we've asked that you read in tandem with the financial memorandum, will add further detail in there. I mean, we have taken out quite a lot of the figures because they're no longer relevant, and I think that is possibly adding to the feeling that there is less detail.
No, I appreciate, you know, there's no point in having it talks about transfer of local authority workers if that's not going to happen, but I just feel that obviously because of the kind of we're keen to get a wee bit more further under the skin obviously of the financial memorandum because of the sheer importance of this bill a financial perspective alone. Okay, well, let's open up now. Well, first person in the committee to ask questions will be joined before by Liz.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener. Convener touched on various areas. I wanted to explore maybe the integration authorities a little bit more. And first of all, just for my ignorance, there's a lot of terms float around here. So we used to talk about integrated joint boards. In Glasgow, we talk about the Health and Social Care Partnership. And now we're talking about an integration authority. Are these just three different names for the same thing?
Not exactly. So the integration authority is how the the integrated partnership is described in the Public Bodies Act. The Integrated Joint Board is the board that delivers that integration authority. The Health and Social Care Partnership is slightly different. That is where you get the operational activity coming together. So I understand that it is confusing, but they're all essentially different, slightly different parts of the entirety of the governance and delivery landscape.
Okay, well, that's helpful. I'll probably explore that on my own at some future point. That's fine. Now, I think some of the points that have been made refer back to the way, let's just call them integrated joint boards, in the past, or integration authorities, and the way the fundings work, because it does seem sometimes that the council and the health board have put in funding and then almost taken it back. And there's a suggestion, if I can find the wording, that it's almost like a circular. It says at one point, funds were ceded to IAs and then largely given back to the hosts. And there's another point where it says, in practice, much of the funding appears to be circular, with funding allocated to the IJB from the local authority and health board, which then directs it back to the local authorities and health boards and health and social care partnerships. Is this going to work better? Is there going to be better integration in going forward? Because on the one hand, integration is a good thing. On the other hand, it can make it difficult for the councils and the health boards to follow the pound.
Yeah, so the Integration Joint Board is responsible for the commissioning of community health and social care support and services. So they undertake the strategic planning. They then commission the services and supports that are required. And because the health boards and local authorities are usually quite often the providers of those services, that is why there is a circular nature there. And local authorities also commission the third sector. It's important to procure from the third sector. So that is where that circular nature comes from. The improvements in terms of the transparency of funding, I think, are important, because there are and a couple of contributors here. One of the things that we're, and the Minister will probably talk about this on Thursday, is keen to understand is the relationship between the strategic plan and the delivery plan and the funding of that, so that the plans are funded and can be delivered. So the consolidation of funding within the IGB allows you to see across the piece from both the NHS and from local government to see what the totality of that funding is and then how it is being spent.
So if the Chief Executive or the Board of the Integration Authority wants to do something or wants to stop doing something, who's going to feed it? Who's going to be answerable to? Will the new national body be able to say no or veto them, or would the health board or would the local council, or are they going to have to keep pleasing all three bodies?
So the locality integration bodies will remain a partnership between the local authority and the NHS. There will likely be other members of the local integration authority, so people with lived experience, carers, etc., as yet to be defined. So at a local level, we're very clear that local decision making is really important here, because we need to make sure that the supports and services that are made available are suitable for that local area. So the current accountabilities to the Integration Joint Board will remain. The Integration Joint Board will be accountable to the National Board for strategic planning and for delivery. And I mean, we will have to ensure that local decision making is still paramount, because it certainly is a real priority for local government that there is an ongoing discharge of their democratic accountability at a local level. But certainly where there are improvements required, the National Board will be able to support areas to make those improvements, and as a last resort will have powers of intervention. So the intention is not to intervene on every decision that government doesn't agree with. The National Board will be able to take a view, particularly on things like statutory duties. If, for example, an area isn't meeting its statutory duties and the Care Inspectorate or another regulatory body flag that, I'm sure that's something that the National Board would be very interested in.
I suppose I was thinking of practical issues. We had an issue in Glasgow, a slightly different topic, with link workers linked to GP practices. Local GP opinion, NHS, what said these are good, we need to fund them. HSCP said can't fund them, government came in with some more money. Would that change in future, do you think, that kind of decision making?
There would certainly be a bit better mechanism for having that discussion and for certainly seeing the impact of the decision, because one of the things certainly that people tell us is that there is not always a comprehensive impact assessment for particularly for the impact on people who use these services. So I think there would be a different relationship with the National Board and local boards. But again, you know, we need to be clear that local democratic accountability will still remain.
Okay, and would that also go, it's suggested that integration authorities could amalgamate or join together. Mm-hmm. Would that be entirely a local decision, or would there be national input in that?
That's the intention. I mean, again, we've spoken with local government and the NHS at length about this. There was a strong view that that shouldn't be a central decision either by ministers or by the National Board. But where areas do want to come together, that should be facilitated. I think there are clear public value opportunities there that local partners may want to take advantage of. So we should facilitate that through this bill.
OK, and just one other point, I think, on the integration authorities. VAT, there's some mention of, and would there be an issue if money did go directly to the integration authorities? Is that create a VAT problem?
So we're still assessing that with Her Majesty's Treasury. At the moment, we don't have a decision on whether the IG, well, we know at the moment IGBs are not VAT exempt. So the issue will be if we do fund them directly, and we're expecting that that is only in very specific and limited situations, that we'll do an assessment at the time. I would expect, though, that we will have a response from HMT in advance of taking any of those decisions. But I think it's important to note that given the specific and limited nature of the likely investments, we would consider those on a case-by-case basis.
OK. Now, something I don't think we've touched on so far is the idea of integrated social care and health records. And it says in the papers that these do not yet exist, and as such will require major investment in their own rights. So am I right in saying there's not money set aside for these records because there could be data sharing without them?
So the bill itself makes provision to allow information to be shared rather than for the creation of the record itself. So we haven't gone into huge detail, and I'll maybe ask Richard to come in on this one, but we haven't gone into detail about the investment in the integrated care record technology. So given that what we're trying to do here is to make sure that information can be shared and that there is a legal basis to do so, that's what we've costed on. Richard, you might want to say a wee bit about the record itself.
So two things. So that's absolutely right. In terms of the actual bill itself and the financial memorandum, there isn't the cost associated with the infrastructure required to support a digital care record now, because it's not a primary part of the financial memorandum. However, separate to this, I think it's quite critical that we recognise this. This is going to be a core plank of our digital investment in health and social care moving forward. So as part of the wider budget considerations for the health and social care portfolio, and particularly the investment made in digital by health boards and indeed local authorities and the Scottish Government, that is something that will be costing up and working forward in the coming months and years as well.
Are there even rough ideas as to what it would cost?
At this stage, we're still working through that, and as you kind of alluded to, there is a lot of capacity within our existing method, existing budgets to proceed with digital sharing that will not incur significant additional costs. However, we're still working through the specifics of the business case around the integrated care record itself.
Okay, thank you. Now, also in the programme business case, I noticed, I think you're kind of contrasting what would happen if we carried on as usual and what could happen if we have the new system. And it says various things: enable strategic integration, national oversight, accountability, and opportunities to invest in preventative care rather than crisis responses, avoiding expenditure and poor outcomes, such as those experienced by people who are delayed in hospital and so on. And the Community Care Lancet, there could be considerable costs that are avoidable if the current system can be improved. Can you go into that a little bit more? I mean, are we saying that just by passing this bill and having this National Care Service, that will automatically produce savings which we can put into preventative care? Because this is something this committee has looked at for quite a long time. Or is it just that there's the possibility of savings?
So one of the reasons that we haven't defined the savings is because we don't want, and I think Lee's already referred to this, we don't want to make what others might appear to what might appear to be spurious claims. So some of the comparisons that we've looked at around improvement, for example, if you consider, and delayed discharge is always a popular area for focus. So if you consider the areas which are performing best on delayed discharge and the areas that are in some real need of improvement, if we were able to improve those areas where there are some real issues, we have done some calculations to suggest the sorts of savings that might be available. And there will be others. If you look at the work that we're doing on getting it right for everyone at the moment, where we're taking a multi-agency, multidisciplinary approach, there are efficiency savings that are being realised there just in terms of things like information sharing and...
surely information sharing can't in itself lead to big savings, can it?
Well, if... and certainly the availability of information. So if you have a person, and some of this is coming out of the Getting It Right for Everyone activity, and it links very much to prevention as well. Some of the serious case reviews that we see as part of the activities underway at a local level, where there has been a lack of multi-agency joined up working, not only are people worse off for that, but the system itself sees a huge amount of inefficiency. If you look at the Hard Edges report that was published a number of years ago now, with people who have multiple services involved in their support, there are estimated savings that could be brought about there. So there are a number of areas where we believe there will be savings, but we haven't recorded them in the programme business case because we don't want to make spurious claims at this point.
Okay, well, just my final question then. You mentioned the programme business case. Am I right in saying it's going to be updated when there's significant changes? So would we see every quarter, would see a new version, or every month, or every 6 months, or how does that work?
So there'll be a few key milestones here. So this is based on the proposals for the amended bill, if you like, for the next phase. Obviously, we will take into account the changes associated with stage two and any change that occurs during that period. There will also potentially be other issues that we need to take into account, you know, in whatever context that is. So I think we would expect, we can bring it back to you quarterly. I think monthly, we won't update it monthly, but we can either agree to do that quarterly or at the point of any significant change, if that would be helpful.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Gideon.
I thought, got exactly in front of you, but I understood that we're saying that even 6 monthly wouldn't be able to report because it contradicts the Scottish Government's actual annual financial assessments, and that it would have to be once a year. Now you're saying it could be once a quarter.
If there is any significant change to the assumptions, i.e. the policy assumptions that we're talking about here, so I don't think we've necessarily changed the financial aspects of it, but we may want to do that in a different way. It's whatever is most helpful for the committee.
Okay, thanks. Liz, to be followed by Michael.
Thank you. Can I pursue the issues around co-design and obviously the implications for cost, which is the central concern for this committee? Can I just have a bit of clarity, please? You said in answer to the convener that there has been considerable co-design over the last 9 months, which would take us back to April 2023. Can I just be clear that there was obviously co-design ongoing before that date, if you could tell us when that co-design started?
So we've been co-designing since the beginning of this process. We set up the initial phase of that with the Social Covenant Steering Group in almost at the same time the consultation began. We also had the consultation process, and throughout that period have had various engagements with people and with stakeholders. The formal, more formal co-design approach with the lived experience expert panel and the stakeholder panel kicked off in spring last year, and we've done a number of areas of work with them, so various surveys, engagement on the charter, and then the broader work over the summer in person and online.
Okay, so the substantial changes that have been made to the bill in terms of no transfer to local authority of staff and assets and no new care board plans, did these changes result from the co-design discussions that you had since spring last year?
So the significant changes on accountability and governance have resulted from engagement with COSLA and the NHS. So the shared accountability agreement and the, I suppose, everything that flows from that. As I said earlier, what we have then done is balanced that with what we've heard from co-design, because something, and I think the Minister will talk about this on Thursday, she has been absolutely clear that she doesn't want the principles or the, the policy intent of this bill to change. So where we have achieved consensus, we have been confident that we can still achieve the aims and the principles of the bill whilst delivering in a different way.
Thank you. Why was that not possible, given co-design was ongoing before? If people were advising of these changes, why did the Scottish Government not respond to that at an earlier point?
So the majority of those changes and the shared accountability activity came from local government, as you will be aware. So we have kept the ongoing conversation with local government since we've introduced the bill. Where there was a change was in May last year, where there was a ministerial decision to re-engage with COSLA and the NHS and to seek to achieve consensus.
And was that decision to re-engage, was that largely out of concerns over costs, or were there other factors that required that re-engagement?
I don't think that cost was at the top of the list. I think there were some questions firstly about relationships with local government. Secondly, about the ongoing deliverability of the work underway, and probably a fair bit of discussion about the potential disruption associated.
That's helpful in a way, but do you accept that one of the difficulties about co-design, which in principle can have a very strong case behind it because you're obviously engaging with the stakeholders who are making representations to the government collectively about what might be the right process, do you accept that because that process is ongoing, it is actually exceptionally difficult to come to any accurate assessment of what the costs are going to be?
So I'm not sure that... I don't accept that we find it difficult to come to an assessment of the costs. I think we do have a range within the costs, and that's illustrated throughout. I think doing the work on co-design over the past... very intensively over the past 9 months or so has allowed us to pin down those costs further, and we now have them within certainly a much more acceptable range.
But is it not the case that co-design is ongoing?
Yes.
So if co-design is ongoing and there are further representations that are made to the Scottish Government about possible changes, does that not have implications for future costs?
So in terms of the primary legislation, I think we're confident that the co-design activity has given us a very comprehensive and helpful set of issues that we need to include, and those have all now been included. In terms of the amendments that may come forward at stage two, obviously there may be amendments, but Scottish Government has set out the amendments that it intends to propose.
Sorry, can we just go back a little bit, because what you're effectively saying is that the co-design up until this point has made the government have a bit of a rethink about the bill and made three substantial changes, but two in terms of reducing the cost, that there's going to be no transfer of local authority staff and assets and no new care boards, saving a lot of costs. Should there be co-design ongoing, and the outcome of that further co-design is that there are more substantial changes suggested, does that not have implications for the cost?
It may do. I mean, I don't see where those substantial changes would add. Where we have got to now, I think, is that we have a good understanding of the framework that's required to deliver both the policy intent and the principles outlined in the bill. So I don't see that we are likely to have more significant change in the primary legislation. The secondary legislation will need to fit in with the frame of the primary legislation, and certainly I don't see any additional.
But if co-design is ongoing, what do you think that these ongoing discussions in co-design will be about if they're not going to make suggestions of further substantial changes?
So I think the ongoing discussions will be about how we deliver on the bill rather than what is to be delivered. If I can perhaps give an example on the national board. So we've defined the intention to have a national board, we've defined the functions, we've set out as best we can at this point in time
I understand that, but the key point here in relation to what you've just said, how it is implemented has a direct relationship to cost, surely.
And yeah.
Our concern in this committee is to try to assess with more certainty, and just as the convener said in his questioning, we need much greater clarity about the nature of the costs that are going to be involved in this bill. That's the central issue. And there may be lots of good things about it. I'm not taking sides on whether it's good or bad. What I think the principal role of this committee is to understand what the future costs are going to be, and therefore how accurate is the new financial memorandum. And I think personally that we have quite a considerable difficulty because of the uncertainty that is unfolding in quite a lot of your answers this morning, because we simply don't know some of these things. Do you accept that?
No, I don't. I think we have built in the range of costs that are required to deliver on the framework of the bill. So,
but are not related to future co-design?
So the future co-design will be about how we deliver the frame of the bill. So the activities that we have undertaken to develop the costs for that have included assumptions. For example, on the National Board, we've included assumptions about the staff that will be required. So the co-design will be about how the Board delivers its functions, and the staff that will be required to deliver those functions have been included in the costings already.
Okay, thank you. I'll leave it there.
Okay, thank you. Now, it should have been Michelle next, not Michael. So it's Michelle to be followed by Michael.
I've been called a lot of things in this committee, convener. Just following up the points that Liz Smith has been making. Oh, my thing has just died. I think what she was trying to flesh out is a concern of mine as well. I can see that you've done a huge amount of work from when we last met, and I absolutely give you credit to that. But actually talks to one of process in terms of co-design, and also mirrors our concerns as a finance committee that to what extent can we be confident that the end cost bears some relation to the start cost, and accepting that the end cost is never accurate. That's the only point when your costings can be accurate, and I understand all that. But the question for me is that as it goes into stage two and amendments, they'll be done by the Health and Social Care Committee, and we won't have the financial scrutiny and oversight of them. And as the co-design process carries on and further business cases are development, that will incur costs. I accept what you're saying about they're being framed. So I do accept that, but it will still introduce further costs over which we will have no oversight over a 10-year period. And it's that. So if you said to me, notwithstanding that you've clearly done a huge amount of good work, and I'm not saying I'm against a co-design process because of the issues that have been brought out today, what I'm remarking on is that as it stands, I personally can't be confident that we as a finance committee have any sense of the ultimate cost of this. And from a parliamentary perspective, that's a concern against a backdrop of huge challenges around public sector funding. So do you accept that kind of framing that I've set out and the rationale I've given?
So I understand what you are setting out there, Ms Thompson. What we have done to the best of our ability is to build in as much of that uncertainty, including the activities that need to be undertaken through co-design. I think Ms Todd has already offered to the committee, that, as we've already referred to, the updated business cases, the specific business cases and regular updates to the Finance Committee. There is also an opportunity for ongoing engagement with Parliament too, but I'll ask Lee to come in.
Yeah, so I think there's 2 points here. So when we're looking at the, in terms of the uncertainty over the costs, there's probably 2 points. So if we look at the revised financial memorandum, still assuming the transfer of staff, still assuming the creation of the care boards, There is a large degree of uncertainty there because you have, in theory, 75,000 staff that may or may not transfer, depending on the type of transfer that they moved across. We've obviously built in a large cost base for them on the shared accountability front. That is removed because we won't be transferring the staff, so that reduces a significant portion of the cost. Linked to that, under the revised FM, or the FM has started, there was a proposal to create 31 care boards, and that entails all the operational costs associated with it. Again, under the shared accountability agreement, we're looking at a reform of the current IGB, and the cost base for them appears to be significantly smaller. So what we're doing is we're taking a large extent of the uncertainties, and certainly we've been costing it, the ones that had the biggest range of potential swing in it, they've broadly been removed. So yes, within co-design, depending on how that is approached, there can be some changes in cost. What I think from having done the revision to the financial memorandum, then looking to do the shared accountability, the potential range of cost differentials, looking at the national board, looking at the reformed IGBs, have been reduced quite considerably. So yes, there will still be variability, but what we've tried to do within that is within reason and looking across. So when we're looking at the national board, we've assumed on the basis, and this is still to be agreed through the ministerial control framework, a sort of non-departmental public body type approach, because for some of the work that we've done before, that looked to be the most expensive. In terms of the scale of it, we've looked at similar NDPBs, so Community Justice Scotland be referenced. We had a couple of colleagues who had worked in the setup of that, and from their involvement in terms of the policy development for the National Board, they felt it was broadly comparable. So we've got reasonable certainty, and it is reasonable because there are still caveats around it, that that should be roughly where it is. The reform of the IGBs, again, there is obviously still question marks around it, and we've got the range, but again, the scale of the change in that is significantly reduced from where we were with care boards. If we look at the Scottish administration costs, you'll have seen a significant drop in that. And
if you don't mind, interrupt, but again, what you're articulating to me increases my confidence level that you've taken on board what we were saying before. These are all examples of that. But it's the basis in which it will proceed. And going back to Ms. Smith's point, the continued co-design, even from a well-estimated framing, has a significant potential of cost overrun, because if you haven't got us breathing down your neck saying, you said this, it's going to be that. I've seen this a million times in another life where, well, we thought it was going to be A plus C plus E, but actually that's a very good point the person over there has made about G, and then you go away and look at it, and that's the critical risk factor in terms of costs that you're outlining. So I've seen this in private industry where in this kind of situation, because this is a function of complexity, why you're doing this way, where you've said, right, there's going to be a fixed budget, that's it, end of. And if you are therefore, as managers come in, they change, are entertaining that, oh, actually, E looks quite interesting, you're then required to say, well, you're going to de-scope and take out because you've got a fixed budget. So maybe the question is that we have ultimately no control over the end cost, despite me crediting you with doing all that work. So has anybody asked a question, allowing for an inflationary uplift, because we can't control that, and various potentially other variables, said, we're going to put a fixed cost on that? Because for me, that would be the real test of how much extra work you've done.
So I think, I mean, we're obviously happy to, we haven't done that, but we'd be happy to consider that. It might be helpful, because a lot of the engagement that we've had on co-design is about working practice rather than financial investment. So thinking about the keeping care and support local theme, people were really clear that there was some excellent care locally, but some of the areas that they were really keen to highlight were areas like no portability of support between local authorities, for example. So we know that this is an issue where there are differences in provision made across. So things like that.
And you're almost making my point for you. Things like that, where there's a very good rationale and there's a very good reason, but that by going through the depth of that discussion by time, but I mean by resource, collecting all that resource rather than necessarily capital expenditure or whatever, that is by necessity going to increase costs because you're doing the job you expected. And so I'm just trying to set out why, from a financial perspective, I ultimately conclude that despite the good work you've done, I think that there will inevitably be significant cost overruns over the time period we've got. And I just again put on record that that's a concern, and it's counterintuitive to a very difficult fiscal environment. So it's a bit technical, I appreciate, but...
So just to be clear, are you talking about the investment in co-design or the...
Yes, I'm talking about the investment time, because that's where often significant costs are incurred by the activity that's doing a good job of working, taking in soundings from other else, you know, and oh, we need to, because if you've got multiple stakeholders, well, we need to work this through with multiple stakeholders, that incurs a real cost on an ongoing basis, which by operating to a fixed budget would keep a sharpness to it, but with no fixed budget line, it won't.
Right, okay, sorry. Yeah. So yes, so we have built in the co-design activity to the programme, both in terms of time and in terms of budget already.
So, in other words, it will not take any longer than what you've already costed?
Yes. So the intention is that we have built that into the programme of activity for development already.
And what happens if somebody comes out with a really good idea that you've not thought of yet?
So the time is built into the programme. What would then happen, if that was the case, is we would pivot our policy approach to that, which may take a bit more time, but it would really depend on what it was.
That's my point. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Michael, followed by Jamie.
Thanks, Convener. I'm keen to get you on the record a little bit about the costs in the first instance, because it's quite an unusual set of papers we have in front of us in terms of there was the original financial memorandum, then there was an updated financial memorandum, and now there's the new financial memorandum. So the first set of figures on the original financial memorandum was it could cost between £644 million or £1,261 million over a five-year period. Is that correct?
I've extrapolated them out over the 10 years to factor in inflation. So if we took the original FM over the full 10-year time frame, it was coming out £1.8 billion to £3.9 billion. If we take, just to, for comparability, just to keep everything consistent.
That was going to be one of my questions. So they, but my figures are correct in that regard. It was the original one was 5 years, but... So
the original was the 5 years. It's then just deliberately just to make a comparison between the original FM and then a revised FM. Yes, so the, if we extrapolate the original FM out, it's £1.8 billion to £3.9. The revised FM will give us £487 million to £1.6 billion. And the real... Well, there's a number. I'll let you finish now.
So could you give me those extrapolated figures again, please, Mr. Flanagan?
Yeah, so the original FM, if we take it over 10 years and we build an inflation and there is a slight tweak in the transfer of the staff, because at the end of the 5 years it hadn't transferred the full 100%, so if I build that in the same model we've got now, we get £1.8 billion to £3.9 billion. That would have been under the original remit that you had the first time.
So if the committee had signed off the original FM, we would be potentially looking at a bill of £3.9 billion. Right, I've not heard that figure before, but maybe that's just my ignorance. On the updated, then, financial memorandum, the figure that I have is £880 million to £2,192 million. That's over 10 years. Is that correct?
And that's fighting in the carers breaks cost, yes, but yeah. That's right.
And the new financial memorandum, given the likely amendments at stage two, is your plan £631 million to £916 million.
Correct.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, that's useful in the first instance. Can I touch on the integration authorities, following on from Mr. Mason's questions? Could you give me the cost of those update, your estimated costs for the changes to the new versions of the IGB?
So
scope for immigration authorities, if we're assuming we'll start phasing it in 26, 27, with a view to going full operation 27, 28, we've got 2.37 million in 26, 27, it then goes to 12 million 27, 28, and then incrementally goes inflation here, so then 12.4 million, 12.7 million, 13.0, 13.4. And so the total cost across that 10-year period would be 65.8. That'd be the mid figure. We've then ranged it either side for us, so the lower estimate and the upper estimate as well.
Okay. Because so £65.8 million. It feels to me, given the answers you gave to my colleague, these are pretty much going to be the same thing. I mean, at the moment we have, take for instance the Health and Social Care Partnership in Dundee, which has 18 members that sit on that board, and the votes are split equally. There's six voting members, three between local authorities, three from the health board. Are you proposing that we change that model?
So that's one of the areas under discussion with local government at the moment. So one of the areas that we have not yet agreed with local government is the prospect of an independent chair of the local bodies. There is also ongoing discussion about the membership that we've discussed, and it may be that the makeup of those boards is different. There are also the accountabilities, which I've already outlined. There are other aspects around improvement and escalation, and there are options for ministers to fund integration authorities directly.
Okay, so I suppose what I think is key within this is perhaps your last point, but in terms of how the dynamics of the money works, because these don't work at the moment because they're joint funded between the NHS and local authorities, and they put money into the pot and then they pull it back out again, and there is no real strategic intent as to what they do, because you have, of the voting members, there are six people, it's 50-50, and then there's, so that's where it lands. Your proposal is then that would be that you change that, or you're just in a process of longer term negotiation about what that might look like?
Yes.
Okay, but you don't think that the fundamental power dynamic of that changes, that the two organisations, the NHS and local authorities, are putting money into the pot to fund the social care outcome?
So I think the funding flows will more or less remain the same. There may be some areas, as I said, in specific and agreed circumstances where government does fund integration authorities directly. I think, and I've already talked a bit about this, the key issue that people have told us they're interested in is transparency. So the creation of the approach to both strategic planning and delivery assurance, particularly assurance around funding for delivery, will give us a much better collective understanding of both strategic planning, delivery planning, and the funding to support that.
And you said earlier in one of your answers that you wanted to enhance local democratic accountability. Local democratic accountability. So of those 18 members of the IGB, Health and Social Care Partnership, Integrated Authority, same thing, in Dundee, there are three elected members out of 18 people. Would your view that then it should be a majority elected councillors on these bodies?
So, as I say, that is still for discussion.
We just don't know. Okay. I think it's really key in terms of that role, because that critical interaction between the two sources of finance is why these are non-strategic organisations, is my view. And if you don't deal with that, and I'm not really hearing any clarity within these proposals as how you're going to deal with those finances differently, because it's all tied up in the votes, as far as I can see, but I don't think we've got answers to that. And then the interaction with the National Care Board, I'm still struggling a little bit to understand from the answers that you've given how the point at which a decision might be taken nationally to instruct one of those integrated authorities to do something. Is that the relationship that you foresee?
I think that is the relationship in extremis. So the intention would be, given the partnership approach, is that the board work together to support local partners to create appropriate improvement support, improvement options, working with obviously the improvement agencies. So everybody who's involved in health and social care is keen to see improvement and is committed to improving. So I think bringing that together on a national basis is a very sensible thing to do. Where there are issues and where those are highlighted, either through data, whether that be performance data, whether it's inspection reports, the development of the escalation and improvement framework will set out where help and support might be required. And you'll all be familiar with the NHS escalation framework. Now, we're not suggesting a carbon copy of that, but it does have some really good learning for us on what works. And certainly earlier support and intervention, and particularly the support part of that to help areas turn around their issues, whether that be on a peer-to-peer basis or whether that be engaging with the improvement organisations or any other organisation who can assist, will be really important. So it's a culture of improvement that we're trying to create, and to create those networks and learning collaboratives. So that's, I suppose, the first bit. Where there are issues that require intervention, you'll know that ministers already have the power of direction under the 2014 Act. So that will remain and not change. But we would expect that the board would be heavily involved in providing support in advance of any ministerial direction.
So the intervention powers are already there. So ministers could do that already. And I suppose I'm wondering about this interaction between what you've said to want to increase local democratic accountability and this national board. So essentially, if what happens locally is the local authority says, we don't have any money, we're skint, we've had our budget cut for over a decade, you know, probably by then by 15 years, we don't have money to put into this or any more money, is your view then that that national body will tell them to put money into it?
Well, that would be a matter for the national board. I don't think it's something that I would envisage happening. There is something there about statutory responsibilities and whether they are being met. I think it will be wrapped up in the deliverability of the strategic plan and being very transparent about what is deliverable. I don't think the National Board, given its potential makeup, will want to be in the position to be directing or ordering local government to do take different approaches.
So how much is that going to cost for this national body then under
this
memorandum?
National board is so we're starting to phase it in. Some of the work will be beginning 24-25. So we've got $500,000 built in for 24-25, running up to $1.4 million 25-26 as we finalise it. We have view to going live 26-27, then it's 4.2, 4.3, 4.4, 4.5, 4.6, 4.8.
And the total?
Total is 28.8. Again, that's a midpoint, and we obviously stretch the upper and lower ranges. Just set out in the report.
So it's £30 million quid to not tell local authorities to do things differently. Under your last, you said you don't envisage local authorities being told that they should do things differently or should spend more money on it.
What I'm saying is that there are powers of direction remain, but the sole purpose of the board is obviously not to tell local authorities what to do. The functions of the board were set out, I think, pretty clearly in the letter. So they are about oversight, they are about support. They're about national standards and making sure that people's human rights are embedded. And, you know, there are a number of areas which both this committee and Scotland have picked up on in the over the past well, certainly thinking about the Audit Scotland report in 2018 and then subsequent reports around issues of data, issues of information and analysis. There are also options for national commissioning and procurement, which is another area that we would expect to see savings on. There are really urgent needs around workforce planning, which isn't done at a local level and is done, I think, in multiple different ways across the different workforces. So I wouldn't suggest that the board has that sole function that you describe, but certainly there are multiple functions that both local government, the NHS and Scottish Government agree will be useful at a national level.
I think that broader illustration is useful. I mean, certainly what I'm trying to explore here is the interaction between how the money is spent and raised and then at a local and a national level, and the point at which there's an instruction around that, rather than saying this is the only function of it. When you talked about co-design, maybe you could explain a little bit about this to me. I find it a little bit difficult to believe that there would be a group of people who are care users, people who rely on care services and the great work that our carers do through local authorities and other areas, came together in a room and said that this is what we need, that what we need in order to make our lives better is a kind of a fairly cosmetic tweak to the IJB and a board that might advise ministers as when they might want to use their powers they already have. Was that the tone of the conversation? I mean, these people with lived experience that you're talking about, I mean, surely what they were saying was, I need more frequent care visits. I need somebody who will be able to stay longer. And I recognise that this is the framework that you're setting out, but the drawing the line between the money that we're spending and this and those outcomes, to me, seems to be pretty tenuous at best.
Okay, so I've already suggested the co-design themes here. So keeping care support local, information sharing, making sure my voice is heard, realising rights and responsibilities and valuing the workforce. So there was some really comprehensive work done. We published 5 reports on those, I suppose, the learning outcomes from those. There were many comments, particularly in keeping care support local, about culture, collaboration, communication, person-centred care, transitions, information sharing. But there were also comments about governance, transparency, accountability and resource allocation. So yes, of course, people told us about their own experiences of care and their very specific circumstances and what they needed. But they were also interested in the infrastructure that supported people who were making those decisions. And we got quite a lot of clear opinions. Certainly we can send the reports to committee if that would be a helpful thing to do. But there were, and the other area which is interesting and useful in this is around information sharing, because issues of governance, transparency and accountability and decision-making on information sharing were highlighted as one of the major areas where people had real issues about their information not being shared, or real issues about barriers being raised because people didn't know what they needed. So while they weren't expressed as we need a national board or this is what the membership of a local care board needs to look like, there were clear themes about those issues that we have reflected in the primary legislation.
That's really useful. Can I close, Convener? There's a presumption against new public bodies and the policy of government, but your view is that would this be an exception? Ministers agreed that this would be a further exception to that rule.
So we still need to pursue the ministerial control framework. We have completed the first stages of the ministerial control framework, and we concluded that it would be most likely to give effect to the shared accountability arrangements that a public body would be likely, which is why we've recorded it as such. But we still need to complete the ministerial control framework and have that agreed. I think also, and Lise mentioned this already, we originally said that we would have the 31, 32 local care boards as public bodies. And we have now concluded that we won't do that, and instead we will have potentially one public body at a national level.
And for clarity on those, because we talked a bit about the different names for the same thing, IGB, Integrated Authority, your suggestion is that the new Integrated Authority will replace what's there. You're not suggesting that would be an additional
further body. It's a reform of the current arrangement.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks, Kevin.
Thank you, Jamie.
Good morning. Michael Myers covered actually quite a lot of what I was looking to cover, but I would just perhaps ask you to look at it from, say, for example, a rural aspect. Can I ask, are there going to be any additional costs to councils that you envisage because of the bill?
No. We haven't included any additional costs to councils.
So, for example, given one of the aspirations, or certainly seems to be about providing access, better access, etc., combating postcode lottery, you'll appreciate that delivering care services in rural island communities is very difficult, extremely expensive, the like. If there is a shortage, as I know there is, a lot of people in parts of my region who are writing to me, they're not writing to me about transparency, they're writing to me, as Michael Myers says, about access, longer, more visits, longer time. How is this likely to improve that access? How is it likely to mean that they're going to get the care support that they're being allocated but not being delivered because of shortage of carers, etc.?
So I'll maybe come to you in a minute, Richard, about specific rural funding issues. But certainly, just picking up on your point about workforce planning, for example, we now, at the moment, have quite a variegated approach to workforce planning, both for social care workers and for social work. One of the priorities, and we have work, quite a lot of work underway already around workforce, there is the Ministerial Task Force on Social Services Workforce underway at the moment. And one of the priorities there is recruitment and retention of social care staff. So it may be that in due course they have a specific focus on rural areas. There are also really promising approaches that are underway around different models of care, different arrangements for the provision of care. So we know that there are cooperatives operating locally in rural areas that are working very well. So I think what we would be very keen to do is at a national level, and thinking about the sorts of activities that the board might undertake, is around sharing the learning around those things that are making a difference, as well as the workforce planning for specific areas.
But this could all be done without a board. This could all be done without these reforms, surely. I mean, councils should speak to each other anyway on best practice and obviously efficiencies. So what additional kind of benefits is this bringing in those scenarios?
So, yes, councils, of course, can and in some cases do. The National Board provides a structure and a forum for that to happen in a planned way and in a very intentional way. I would expect that the data and the additional information that is able to be gathered at a national level will really lend itself to an improved position. It also allows us to bring in I suppose the range of partners more coherently, so the Care Inspectorate, the SSSC, IRIS and other bodies who are involved in the social services workforce. So I think there will be additionality provided by the National Board. Richard, do you want to say anything about rural funding?
Yeah, just very briefly. So funding is based on two separate formulas, one that is allocated to local authorities and one that is allocated to health boards, and that funding is then passed through to the integration authorities. And both those formulas, so in the case of the NHS, the NRAC formula, it takes into account a range of factors, including that remote and rural point that you make. That doesn't necessarily take away the workforce challenges, But in terms of the funding, that is to reflect the remote and rural factors. And that is updated annually, and it is updated to reflect changes in demographic and other factors. I think what the advantage, as I say, that the current formula has been based on those two formulas coming together to give that allocation to integration authorities. I think one of the benefits of having that national oversight will be to look at that funding mechanism and to continue looking at that. And, you know, it is complex. There's many factors that go into that. But that national oversight is another thing that that board can do to help ensure that the funding formulas are appropriate and right moving forward.
OK. Well, take a scenario then. For example, somebody has been, somebody's not getting the care that they should be in somewhere in the Highlands. There's also a number of different ways. A number of people aren't getting that. It is an issue. What practical role can the national board play in that? And if there is an identified issue about funding, will they have any scope to allocate more funding? They don't hold reserves themselves, do they?
So I can cover the first bit, Richard, if that's okay. So the National Board will build a much better understanding of things and areas like unmet need, because we don't have a good understanding of that across the country, which then allows us to plan to meet unmet need, which is, I suppose, point number one. The areas that we would also want to focus on around issues of workforce that I've already mentioned, and making sure that the demand and capacity is matched up. That's something that we would expect to see in any strategic needs assessment that would flow through to a strategic plan. So we would be expecting the National Board to be looking at that type of information to understand whether areas are matching their capacity to their demand. And then if that wasn't the case, so this is all hypothetical, obviously, but if that wasn't the case, we would then want to, the National Board would likely want to engage with them to see what that mismatch was and how improvement and support could be provided to help them to get that into balance.
That intervention is not going to be fiscal. It's going to be essentially advisory and other forms of support. It's not going to be a financial intervention or a legal intervention to say that, you know, you've got to deliver these. Because, you know, no, I doubt any council is delivering a poor standard of service intentionally. They're doing it because of challenges they face. So I'm struggling to understand how this new system is really going to help with that in those cases.
So the Care Inspectorate, as you know, already have a fair amount of regulatory activity underway on the provision of care, and they do thematic inspections on, you know, various different aspects of care. So it may be the case that areas will be found to not be meeting the standards, and then there is a statutory responsibility for them to get back on track on that front. So I suppose one of the things that was discussed in that joint accountability arrangement that was agreed with both COSLA and the NHS is that local government and the NHS were very keen to retain the functions and the associated statutory duties that were already with them. So they are continuing with those and are absolutely committed to meeting them. As the board develops, and again, this is hypothetical, it may be that if areas aren't meeting their statutory duties, there could be a further intervention either from the regulatory bodies or indeed from the board itself in terms of that escalation framework or powers of intervention.
Okay. Look, I mean, I appreciate the carriage breaks is obviously a large part of the cost here, but as colleagues have highlighted, there's been lots of changes to the original plans. If you take out the carriage breaks, which I would have thought could be delivered in perhaps in other ways, but are we now left with essentially quite a kind of costly rebranding of what we had previously, but with a few kind of additional tweaks in there? Or do you think this is now still a substantial change to what's being, to the kind of care landscape?
Yes, absolutely. The functions that the National Board will take on, and that shared accountability agreement is definitely significant. I think it's really important to look across the bill as well. So we've focused an awful lot on the structures aspects of this, and a bit on carers. But as you know, looking at the entirety of the bill, the areas around the charter, complaints and redress, the aspects that support a whole range of, cultural change within the first parts of the bill. And then when you look at the final part of the bill and think about both the carers' support parts, but also the parts that pertain to Anne's Law, the bill in its entirety, I think, is a very strong package of change.
Okay, and just lastly, on the National Board, who will lead that? Who'll head that up?
So the intention at the moment is that, and the Minister will confirm this, is that there is an independent chair of the National Board.
And will there be a chief executive sitting under for the professional side of it? Or?
So the makeup of the administrative function is as yet to be determined, and we've said that we would bring back the business case to this committee for further scrutiny.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks very much, Jamie, and thank you. Just a couple of points to finish off, and it's just one to follow up really what John Mason was saying on the IT kind of front. I mean, in the new financial memorandum, it says that from 23 to 24 through 25, 26, costs are significantly lower than previously estimated. And it talks about the internal staff skill set will be utilised in favour of externally contracted services. I'm not really sure what that means. The internal staff skill set will be utilised in favour. I would have thought it would say the internal staff skill set will be utilised rather than externally contracted services. Seems to me a contradiction there. And then it goes on to talk about it's expected that a portion of the staff costs will be the data and digital space, some which will be shorter-term contractors with specific skills for set periods of time. I mean, contractors, whenever you see contractors, you'll see pound signs ratcheting up pretty quickly. So I'm just wondering where the parameters are for that.
Yeah, so wherever possible, we will take advantage of, probably the wrong expression, but we will use the skills that we have, and it's only in very specific circumstances where we don't have the skills necessary or we can't access them through internal resources that we would engage with contractors. And I think digital is a very specific area where that might be the case. But I mean, Richard, you've got more experience of this.
Yeah, I suppose. So I think you're right, and I think the push and the scrutiny that we'll always push is if we don't need to use contractors, we shouldn't and we won't. That's the position that we would take. I think one thing that I would really want to highlight is, yes, this is the focus is on the National Care Service, but we mentioned the care record earlier. That will have huge implications and a huge potential for the NHS as well. And we have within National Services Scotland a core and key digital function in there, and I think the key thing, as well as the skills within the civil service and the Scottish administration, is making sure that we get the best use and the best value from our agencies within the NHS as well. So that would be our a key component of this as well.
Okay, thank you. And just my final question is about timescale. I mean, we've seen a 1 year delay in this stage one process. However, what we see is that there's a 3 year delay in full implementation to 2028-29. Now, that's more than 4 years away. So we're going to have a stage one debate, in a few weeks, and then we're going to have more than 4 years before this is fully implemented. And it's hard to see why, given the fact that there's actually been a reduction in terms of what the bill's trying to achieve. We're not going to have the transfer of 75,000 staff, blood assets, etc. We're not going to have 31 care boards, or 32 potentially. We'll have one national care board. It almost seems as if there's a lack of a sense of urgency in this. Is it because of lack of resources to deliver? I'm just wondering if you can advise as to why we're having such a huge delay in the actual delivery of this bill.
Yeah, so our priority has been to make sure that there's a safe and secure transition for people, and I would absolutely agree that the new arrangements will be smoother in terms of that transition. But the most important thing, I think, for everybody involved in this programme of work is continuity of care and making sure that people get the support they need. I think we have been pessimistic. Again, I mean, our overarching approach to the planning and the financial costings for this bill has been one where we have built in as much contingency as possible, and that applies as much to the deliverability as it does to the financial costings. So it may be that as we work through the activity needed, that we will be able to do it more quickly. And if we can do that, of course we will, but we need to make sure that it is deliverable and safe and secure for people.
It's just that if people know they're working to a four-year deadline, it doesn't exactly, you know, create any oomph behind the delivery of a bill. If you know it's expected to be delivered in a year or 2 years, it does create a greater sense of urgency. I just find it really bizarre that a bill which has got less content than it had a year ago has got twice as long to implement. I mean, I'm just wondering what the logic for that is. I know you've said it's a bit pessimistic. I prefer realism to optimism or pessimism, but it's quite a significant increase in the timescale for a bill that's it's not as complex as it was a year ago.
Yeah, and while it is not as complex as it was a year ago, I think it is potentially still quite complex. So, I mean, we will continue to look at the phasing as we go along, and if we can do this more quickly, we will be very happy to do so.
OK, well, thanks very much. That's something certainly returned to on Thursday. So I want again to thank Donna Bell, Lee Flanagan and Richard McCallum for their contributions. The committee will continue to take evidence on the updated financial memorandum at its next meeting, which will be on Thursday, when we'll hear from the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport. That concludes the public part of today's meeting. We'll now move into private to discuss our work programme and just call a 3-minute recess. Thank you.